We've tried everything. This metal is psionically charged, rendering it effectively indestructible. Well, in such an extreme situation, I suppose it's possible to cause it harm, but I don't think anything we have is going to make a dent in it.
Then what's our plan?
Ray, you two check out that side.
I think I'm picking up something odd here. What's your take on this? An indestructible gate attached to a damaged frame. A few concussive hits and the hinges might just break loose.
They're too well protected. Our energy streams aren't going to hurt them.
Peter, go kick one.
The only hope we have is to stay alive and keep them away from the Ecto.
I wholeheartedly agree with Rick.
More precisely, they're little stone engines capable of attaining speeds of 198 feet per second before they
get on to something,
which is us.
The particle throwers aren't doing anything to them. Tether them and smash them into something. On the right.
Looks like a good place for slime tethering.
Thanks for joining the party.
I think we're getting close.
Hey, guys, a little help? I bet we could pull these gates down. Hey, Rick, we got a chain or a winch for this thing?
I didn't plan for a fun-filled day of off-roading with Ecto-1, so no.
The tether might prove useful here.
Okay, kid. Tether the gate to my bumper, and I'll pull it down. Okay, good. Give me a few more, just to be sure. Not bad!
This way, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Nicely done.
I'm not sure going underground now is a good idea.
Come on, Spangs. Getting there is the fun part.
This matrix is becoming increasingly unstable.
Uh-oh.
Check that. That's our next stop.
I feel like you're being watched.
Deagon.
What?
Please.
Get ready. Same drill as before.
Hook me up again. I'll take care of it.
Right. The tethers.
At least the tethers help. My fault. Miscalculated.
Winston! It's stuck. For real.
Ecto-1.
She's tough, but she took that pretty hard.
Can you get her rolling again?
Nah. Crickets. She's down for the count, guys.
I hate leaving her here like this.
I know it, Ray. This is definitely turning into a bad neighborhood, but we've got to keep moving.
Guess we're walking from here.
Some of us have been walking.
Keep your eyes peeled!
I think we've got guests.
I knew it!
People are gonna wish we had that super slide. To harness their interdimensional cranial energy source.
To be the key.
Come on, guys, let's put our heads together. Those fellas turned out to be pretty helpful.
This team can play, no doubt about it.
Exciting, somehow risky.
Wait, it's Ilsa.
It's Peck.
Can't we blast them?
Just ones really hard. Nobody's gonna know.
Easy, Venkman. Everything points to Peck being a pawn.
I couldn't have said it better myself.
It's the mayor.
No, Ray, it's not. It's Evo Shandor.
Shandor possessed the mayor, turned Peck on us to slow us down, and when we shut down his Mandela before he could get fully juiced, he hijacked our ghost out of the containment unit as an alternate energy source.
Very good. And they say you're the slow one.
Wait, what? Who says that?
Everybody. What's the girl have to do with it?
Taking her was necessary. To assume my own destructor form, I require blood. My blood.
What about Gozer? I thought you built this all for him.
I did, but he failed me. Twice. How he earned the title the Destroyer is beyond me. Anyway, I thought to myself, why worship a god when you can actually become one?
Slime him.
Shielding.
Shoot on him!
Not much longer.
He's through! Now deactivate your pulse, and we'll cross the streams with the blast function.
I can't shut mine down, Ray.
Me too.
Me neither, I mean.
Who decided to reinforce these shoulder straps?
Yeah! Hey, Shandor, where's your destructor form now? Leave it in your other suit.
I have chosen. I am the Destructor. I am the Architect.
Oh, was someone waking out of their nap?
Oh, no.
That's very bad.
The Architect? That's not so scary. The Contractor, that's pretty cool.
Peter, you don't understand. He's the Architect, and he controls Ghost World.
And he can come into our world. And what do Architects do?
Well, they dream, and they have mechanical pencils, and they forget to put in linen cloths.
I will pay all your fees to start anew. I will fill your seas with concrete and stone.
Whoa, take a break. Do you ever shut up?
Yeah. No! Listen!
I will pierce your world with girders of steel and panes of glass.
That's just mean supervillain threats, right? All those guys talk.
I will crush your world under the weight of my cities. I will smother your creation under my own.
For breakfast. I'm deactivating the cross-stream governor. I never thought I'd say this again. Cross the stream!
We eat gods for breakfast?
Too much, you think?
No, I liked it.
I've got you.
Get me down from here. Please,
Nuba.
I'm begging you, let me down. This is not the last you will see of me.
Ghostbusters. Hey, fellas. What are you doing here? What am I doing here? Where is here?
You were the victim of a transdimensional possession, Your Honor.
What's that mean?
An evil ghost was walking around in your body for a few months.
Whoa. Did anyone notice? Well, how's my approval rating?
Well, you got reelected.
By the way, you're a descendant of Shandor.
Yeah, I kinda got that. What?
Don't cross the streams. Why? It would be bad.
Total protonic reversal.
All right, that's bad. Okay. All right, important safety tip. Thanks, Egon.
You know, Ghostbusters was kind of unusual in that it was one of the first epic scale comedies.
If there's a steady paycheck in it, I'll believe anything you say.
You know, we did two movies. We spent almost a year, you know, all total working together.
I think everybody realized what original material it was.
Hello, Ghostbusters.
The way Dan described the Ghostbusters, we were like Orkin Man, and we were no more impressed by these apparitions and manifestations than you would be by an outbreak of ants or roaches in your kitchen.
I'm Walter Peck.
Great. How's it going, though?
You have the comic geniuses of our generation, and they've known each other for years, and they're hysterical.
It's the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
When we look back at our library and we think of what has, you know, premium value and what the fans love, it's always been, in our minds, Ghostbusters.
The wonderful thing about the movies is they hold up after all this time. But now we're in a different place. Gaming has been moved to a whole other dimension, and it gives the fans something that they've been waiting for.
In film, it's kind of tough to break that fourth wall and turn to the audience and say, come with me. Now the audience and the player are one. The game format enables us to actually include the Ghostbusters viewing audience.
Ghostbusters is the video game I've always wanted to make since I've been in the industry. And I've only waited till the technology met up with what the movie could do before I started it.
We came, we saw, we kicked its ass!
Bill Atherton is back as Walter Peck, the EPA guy. Annie Potts is back as Janine. And then all the Ghostbusters is Ernie Hudson, Danny, me, and Bill Murray.
Having Dan Aykroyd makes the game. Having Bill Murray, having, you know, Harold Ramis and Ernie Hudson, that makes the game.
I mean, you have to have Janine answering the phone at Ghostbusters headquarters. I mean, you can't have someone else do that.
Ghostbusters, what do you want?
My character has, it feels like, as we record the dialogue, that my character has a lot of instructions. Egon is the logical, systematic one.
I didn't realize I had so many memorable lines until 25 years later somebody will go, that's a big Twinkie.
That's a big Twinkie.
Bill Murray's character, Venkman, kind of holds down that kind of dry, skeptical, mundane quality. And that makes for a lot of comedy.
It's right here, right? It's looking at me.
He's an ugly little spud, isn't he?
I think he can hear you, Ray.
If there was a movie script as long as a game script, the film would be, it would be like all the Lord of the Rings films strung together. It's about 1,000 pages because you have to cover all these alternatives.
When I first heard about it, I thought, okay, well, you know, maybe it will be different, but all the characters really ring true.
It looks more like the sequel than a game. It tells the third story. You know, I watched the first two movies in preparation for it, and harking back to that enthusiasm that I had when I first wrote it.
When Dan announced that, you know, he and Harold would actually love to write the script, that you're like, because you're worried, you know, can we pull off the comedy of those first two films? Well, now we have the script writers from those films.
This chapter of Ghostbusters takes place in 1991. 2 years after Ghostbusters 2, because they like wanted enough time to pass where things can settle down from the last movie.
Always wanted a marine component to the Ghostbusters, so in the game there might be structures in and around the river outside Manhattan Island. Without giving too much away, certainly has that.
Well, for the story of the game, they have this the great device of this mandala with nodes that represent different focal points of turbulence in the city.
We're paying the Ghostbusters very well through these city contracts. That's the way it works now, yeah. Like the sanitation department, the police department, the fire department. It was always to be such, you know, that Ghostbusters were to be an essential sanitation arm of living in urban life.
The city had taken out a insurance policy against the Ghostbusters, so everything's billed to the city directly. But with all this destruction they're doing around town, the bills are getting quite enormous. So the mayor hires Peck as a paranormal oversight committee. So he's there to check the books to make sure the Ghostbusters are doing everything properly. And every time you destroy something in the game, he's going to be in your face.
Never done a game, so it was all new.
I am Walter Peck, sir, and I'm prepared to make a full report. These men are consummate snowball artists.
It's hard to get rid of old Peck. The most intense thing that happens to him now is that he becomes possessed.
And my first official act is going to be suspending these idiots' operating license.
Yeah, they needed a average-looking Joe Blow off the street to play the rookie character, and I successfully campaigned for that spot. You'll recognize the back of my ears really well.
Well, the player is a cadet. He's a rookie. He joins the Ghostbusters, and there are new problems at the library. There's museum problems. The Hotel Sedgwick makes another appearance. Certain familiar entities recur in the places where they first appeared in the film. So Stay Puft Marshmallow Man back on the streets of New York, Slimer's back in the hotel, which is a nice kind of callback to, it may evoke a little nostalgia in the player.
All of the equipment and all of the locations and all of the characters and everything are absolutely eye-popping in this game. So it's done with real affection for the original concept. We're just able to go places that we weren't able to go in the movies. It really is, to me, the third movie.
The elements of the supernatural allow you to create monsters and creatures that are visually really interesting, and all kinds of tools and weapons that are the staples of video gaming.
The game, it's funny, the interiors are a lot more vivid than a film, and then the exteriors, and we get to take advantage of the streets, the river, the buildings, and go places where you just couldn't go in a movie, you know.
The gameplay in this game is unique. You're shooting a proton pack that's nuclear charged. It should blow up in a 3-mile radius, and you're using it to wrangle ghosts, and it's more of a, you're not shooting to destroy, you're shooting to capture. So this is the first game where you're out there and you're wrangling things and moving them around into a trap. You're trapping beings.
If you were going to either trap ectoplasm or trap a full material apparition, you'd have to do it on a subatomic particulate level. You'd need some pretty sophisticated equipment. I figure it would cost about $90 billion to build build a prototype of one of those things.
Dan immediately came back and told us, no, they need to be called this, this, and this. And he had definite technical terms.
Bosons are the inner parts of the atomic structure, and they're very elusive, you know, like mesons, muons, gluons. You know, there's a whole science now that tries to trap these invisible particles. It's very dangerous playing with this stuff.
Throw it! I did that, that's my fault.
It's okay, the table broke the fall.
Composite particle system is similar to a distillery in the field of making corn liquor. What you're doing is you're doing an original collision, and then you're basically forcing it back through a filter, but it forces them back through where they've already been, and then out through your wand. Yeah. Again, very expensive equipment. Very, very expensive.
You know, it's just occurred to me, we really haven't had a completely successful test of this equipment.
I blame myself.
So do I.
Well, no sense worrying about it now.
Why worry? Each of us is wearing an unlicensed nuclear accelerator on his back.
When we set out to work with the developer, we interviewed actually quite a few, and Terminal Reality came in with a demo.
that quite honestly blew us away.
Infernal Engine, our internal engine here at Terminal Reality, really, really allows us to create a living, breathing world, so to speak. We can put literally thousands of objects moving in through the environment at once. You can blow apart things. I mean, pretty much in a video game, you have to have walls, a floor, and a ceiling. Other than that, everything's fair game to be destroyed in Ghostbusters.
In Ghostbusters, the video game, there's a lot of different equipment that the player has at their disposal. We've kind of taken the traditional proton stream and we've added some elements to it. If this was a movie, there wouldn't be the level of environmental destruction. We kind of go above and beyond.
All the crowds, all the individual people actually have their own AI. There's no flocking AI. It's not herding.
I think one of the biggest challenges of working on this game is everybody wants this to be a great game. And then we bring to that the burden of knowing that gamers out there want this to be a great game.
One of the nice things about our engine is the way it handles physics. So we were able to take our boss fights, and there's some boss fights in there where they actually use the environment against you.
You know, this looks solid, this looks solid, this all looks solid, everything looks solid around us, but it's not solid at all. It's a seething mass of atoms. You know, you've got your nucleus and protons and electrons, and you've got your paths around the nucleus, and then what's in between those paths and the nucleus, but space, matter, the same dark space that's out in the universe that we see, you know, between the stars. And antimatter is a large part of what was created at the Big Bang. And in Ghostbusters, you know, we were able to use that and put it into the positive world in the service of, you know, cleaning out pesky spirits and stuff.
So our objective from the very beginning with this game is that every minute of this game needs to be either fun, funny, or scary. And being a Ghostbuster, which is the ultimate experience we could deliver to a player.
In this game, much like the movies, the player is going to be experiencing the equipment on the fly. Ghostbusters tend to go by the seat of their pants, and they don't often have much prep time.
Slime Tether masters plasma, and masters the plasma energy in the multiverse everywhere, so, and enables the operator to hold on to entities that would go back to the dimension they came from or vanish. They can't do it if once the Slime Tether touches them. Think of it as a, I guess, the glue on the bottom of a fly's, you know, foot. It's that kind of viscous, almost like a psychically viscous material.
My God is the question. No, but if asked, I always say I'm a God, yeah.
Are you a God?
No.
Then,
we've actually managed to surprise most people at the end. There is a twist ending where people are actually taken aback.
I do feel the fans have been looking for something else, you know, ever since we did the second one.
We felt like of all the movies that we have, this definitely is a video game.
It's a special moment for all the Ghostbusters fans that have been wanting another storyline for Ghostbusters for 20 years, and to get the talent back together, to get the band back together, to get Sony willing to say yes, it's a perfect storm with the right engine, right license, and right talent.
Get her!
Thank you.
remember the satisfaction in finding the hearse. The big steering wheel and the big cabin, and of course we had our fun with it, driving it around.
Ecto is just this great character of the film. It's funny, it's sci-fi, it's cool, it's nostalgic. And we had this vision of getting Ecto-1 totally refurbished.
You can restore any kind of vehicle, but to have something like Ecto, you don't get that opportunity every day.
The Ecto is certainly a piece of Hollywood history. You want it to look its best. And when somebody like Mr. Aykroyd is going to visit us, I want the customer to be 100% happy.
One of the interesting things when we started the refurbishment piece was realizing that Ecto-1 really is the genesis of Dan. He knew that there was this car he had in mind.
Dan is so technical. His script would describe things in exact detail. And he got a friend of his to do illustrations with the script.
Well, the car originally was black with all kinds of really black electronic brushed boxes on it and you know, deep purple lights and everything. And then we paint it up and bring it out as follows. This was a lighter and kind of a brighter paint scheme. You can see that we made the right decision there.
Dan had always wanted to have an old used ambulance as the basis for the Ectomobile. And that just seemed so funny and so right for the movie.
Because it kind of looks a bit clown car. I mean, and you know, we did have some great clowns in the picture.
We came, we saw, we kicked its ass.
Car is based on a 59 Cadillac, Series 62. Miller Meteor built those cars for ambulance and hearse setups.
You go back to 1959, the car designers at the time wanted to make this car look like it could fly. It has elongated tail fins. It's got a very big body, almost like a spaceship or an airplane.
We needed streamlining, be able to corner, be able to go through tunnels in New York City. But it also had to have the capacity to carry the four people and also just the level of equipment we had to carry.
They're heavy. They're not the best handling cars in the world. So some of the stuff that they put the car through in the show is pretty amazing for the amount of weight that was in the car.
Ecto actually makes a great appearance. It's probably one of my all-time favorite grand entrances in a film. It's like a superhero tearing out of a phone booth. You just can't get better than that big, barreling 1959 Cadillac chassis rolling down the street with that siren blazing in wild colors.
Looking the way it did with this logo on the side, you had to smile, you had to laugh. So it achieved what we wanted it to right away.
Over the past 25 years, it's been in parades, it's been in theme park attractions. Wherever that thing has ever been, it has been just an amazing appearance. It has been a huge success. So when we were deciding to relaunch Ghostbusters as a major next-gen video game, we started realizing we gotta get Ecto-1 out on the road. And that's a great realization, but then the next dawning was, yikes, it needs a lot of work, you know.
Need some suspension work and shocks and brakes, brake pads, lining, steering box, transmission, rear end.
I got a call from Keith Hargrove, you know, asking me, we want to use Ecto like a promotional bit, and we're thinking about, you know, cleaning thing up real nice, make it look great. So we do that here.
We knew that Cinema Vehicle Services had a background. First time you visit their warehouse, it is an eye-opener. You know, if you say, I need 17 police cars from circa 1984, they have it, or they'll build it. And Ecto-1, we just felt like we had a perfect fit, and that's when the refurbishment process really took off.
The car came in, it had been sitting for a long time. The belts, hoses, fluids, you know, carburetor, fuel tank, all the fuel lines, most of the wiring, you know, had to be refurbished or replaced.
The body has had a lot of weathering over the years. There were some rust issues that probably were inherent with that car when they first bought it.
When we first started with Ecto, we probably took 200 pictures from every angle, inside, outside, under the hood, every little, I mean, almost the screws, you know. And then it really helps out when you're restoring a vehicle.
The basic premise of it was that we wanted to make, especially the exterior Ecto-1, as close to the original was.
We disassembled what we needed to on the exterior components. We sent all the exterior components to our different departments, to fabrication, electrical, and had those parts gone through.
The very first time I got kind of scared was the day I got there and all the accessories had been lifted off the car, so it was just stripped bare. And that was the day I realized to myself, well, there's no turning back now. We have to refurbish this car because we just dismantled it.
Bodywork was pretty tough. Just as much sheet metal as need be. And then it was time to put Ecto back together. We end up restoring the light bars on the top of Ecto, replacing the lens, polishing some lenses.
A lot of the old motor mechanisms, we had to upgrade them and put newer motors in them. And then I remember we ran that car for about a day and a half, literally about 12 hours a day, just to try to get it to fail. And there were certain things that did fail, but we wanted to make sure it was dependable.
While this process was going on, you know, he said, Sony's talking about giving us some audio-video components. You guys capable of doing that? Sure.
A few issues on the audio equipment that you and I have been talking about is making sure, first of all, that when we put it in, it doesn't look too out of place. You know, we need to sneak it in strategically to where everyone doesn't go, hey, that wasn't a part of the original. You know, so we want to keep the asset pure.
They wanted to upgrade it a little bit, but there again, just not take away from the fact of what it was.
Instead of just plopping speakers where people would traditionally put them in door panels, we're going to hide them.
Yeah, we have a couple hidden compartments.
Because this was a combination hearse, ambulance, body, there was all these little side compartments and doors and everything, and everything fit really cool into that, like it just existed. So it is actually something that just turned out perfectly.
Even the DVD audio-video system we put up in the upper compartment, where the divider panel is between the driver compartment and the rear compartment. It's all hidden away, so when you look in Ecto, it doesn't look like this thing's been completely modified. The reaction you get having that car here is unbelievable. Everyone that came here, if they had a glimpse of it, it's like, oh, wow, it's Ecto, I want to take a photo with it. It's like, oh, no, no, you can't.
As far as the fan aspect of it, we were doing research on the cars, and I came across fan websites, and it's kind of neat that these people build replicas of cars. I'm all for that.
I couldn't believe how many different vehicles that are being built out there. I mean, it's like they're into it.
During the refurbishment, we started realizing that there were people out there that climb fences and sneak into garages.
Basically, I felt like a detective. I had to watch people coming in the shop. I actually caught a couple guys with a camera. I had to chase them all around. But, I mean, that's how much attention that car gets, where you can get people trying to sneak in our shop taking pictures.
There's always stuff that comes up that you don't anticipate, especially when you're working on a 40-year-old car. It was a bit of a challenge trying to find some old bits and gadgets to restore some of the outside pieces. So a lot of it was just handmade stuff. We got stuff from all over the world. The windshield came out of South Africa, if I'm not mistaken.
I was really worried that the chrome, you're not going to find too many chrome pieces that fit a 1959 Cadillac anymore. And if you do, it's probably going to need an extensive amount of polishing and refurbishment.
Well, everything we did to Ecto, it was a little tricky. But once you start putting all the chrome on it, that's when you start seeing the car.
And then last and least is pretty much just the upholstery and the paint work on it. We polished up the gurney. You know, we're able to do a lot of stuff with the electronics. And you step back and you look at it and you go, that's cool. Yeah, that looked good. Yeah, that's nice.
We started realizing, you know, step by step, we were getting there. We were actually getting closer.
Great. Oh, well.
We knew we sort of had a VIP coming. And it wasn't just to drop by. We knew that it was also sort of an unofficial approval process of how well did we do.
Sir?
How do you do?
Mr. Aykroyd, Ray Claridge.
Ray, thank you so much for welcoming me to the gates of heaven, Cinema Vehicle Services. Only in Hollywood could you have a place like this.
There was a buzz around the shop when the word got out that Dan Aykroyd would be here. Everybody was coming up to me, oh, is that true?
People that I have working for me, a lot of them been here for a long time. So certainly when somebody like Mr. Aykroyd is going to visit us, you know, it's a big boost for us.
Well, there was a little anxiety, you know, getting to meet somebody that you used to watch as a kid, you know, and now I'm working on stuff that he's working on.
Everything kind of led up to that meeting. And so there was an extra level of nervousness on my part. It was like, is Dan going to like, you know, this car?
But let us show you what we did.
Wow, look at that Cadillac.
first time you see the car on film, you're like, wow, it's a big car. It's pretty impressive. First time you see it in person, I mean, it is honking huge. It's the prehistoric SUV.
Congratulations, first of all. Maha, I mean, this is magnificent.
It's been an endeavor of
joy.
You.
Oh, it's beautiful.
I'm sure he was surprised seeing the car from, you know, 25 years ago to now, seeing it in a different state.
Well, when he first saw the car, I think he was quite surprised at how much of the originality was still there. And it shocked me of his knowledge, actually. I mean, he knows a lot about those old Cadillacs.
Now, this, of course, is the 59 Cadillac, which was based upon, I think, either an M&M or Hassan Eisenhart coach. I'm not sure.
This one, I believe, is the M&M coach.
M&M coach, yeah. 58, a little different fin. But, I mean, that is positively just impaling. But you've just flawlessly brought it back. God, I'm glad I didn't have to pay for this.
Dan really is the tech wizard and can talk about the car in levels that no one else can talk about the car.
Those are muon scrubbers up there.
Okay. Yeah. We had lost that in the translation. Yeah.
Everything on there has a reason, for sure. There's the radio, you know, GPS locator. There's, you know, high-intensity microphones, EMF scrubbers. It was all related to the hardware needed to go out and do what we had to do, which was a dirty, dirty job.
Dr. Spengler had to miniaturize this for mobile purposes. That's how brilliant Dr. Spengler was.
It was very tough to get it back up and running since we didn't have the schematics on it.
No, that's right, that's right.
He had a backstory for every gadget, and he wasn't making it up. Theoretically, if you gave him enough time and enough money, he could make that stuff work.
Now, these condensers in here, I assume, are for these landing strobes that we have. These are aircraft landing strobes.
You really get that thing that it was not just another prop, that it wasn't just something in their holster. It was like a buddy that was along the ride for the filming.
Even when the camera wasn't working, I think we took it for a few spins. I know Marie and I went around the corner for a cigarette in it a couple of times, absolutely. I used to take naps in the back seat there. Because you've got the jump seats, you know, and it's the perfect length to stretch out, you know.
We were in the back seat, and he was looking at the DVD display of the movie. And at that moment, he was just a guy enjoying the movie and enjoying the car.
Kind of brings it all back again. I'm so proud of the way it holds up, really. The film holds up really, really well.
Yeah, I think he wanted to, just for old time's sake, get in it and rev it up and drive it, and just to bring back his memories, too.
Sounds good. Cool.
Oh, he was chomping at the bit, I think. He jumped right in and fired it up.
Feels good, man. So we're going to take this thing for a little cruise. It's got that beautiful Cadillac motor.
I pushed it pretty hard at driving it, you know, absolutely. I got some sparks out of it and leaned on it a little bit.
Oh, yeah, they got it running good.
You know, just seeing him take off and hearing him corner around a couple of corners, it was like, oh, that was cool. That was cool watching those two get together again.
I think he'd have taken it home if he could have, but it made it out and it made it back, so, you know, our job was done.
As we were really getting close to the end of the refurbishment process, you know, it was quite a journey. There was a lot that we were impressed with Cinema Vehicle Services. We did this for the promotional value, of course, but as the process kept going, we started realizing we're doing this really for the fans.
We put so much time and effort into the car. The thing means a lot to me. You know, seeing it finished from when it first got here to, you know, it leaving completed, I'll have memories forever. And having Dan Aykroyd come over, I mean, God, that's something that, you know, I'll be telling my grandkids about for years.
You know, this is the real car, and that's what was special to us. You know, if Sony would have come to us and said, look, we want to build 3 copies of the Ecto, you know, it had been another job. But when you get to take a piece of Hollywood history and rebuild it, and then a new generation of fans get to see it, that's special.
Ecto One really holds itself well up there in the pantheon of movie vehicles. The people who worked on the car were able to elaborate on it to the magnificence that you see here. I never thought I'd see it shined up and looking so good.
Well, it's gonna have to do a lot of work around the country, but for ghost busting, you can't beat it.
Thank you.
strange noises in the middle of the night.
Do you experience feelings of dread in your basement or attic?
Have you or any of your family ever seen a spook, specter, or ghost?
If the answer is yes, then don't wait another minute. Pick up your phone and call the professionals. Go Ghostbusters! Our courteous and efficient staff is on call 24 hours a day to serve all your supernatural elimination needs.
We're ready to believe you!